and thank you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with the church and her children. To the good one be glory and honor on this blessed Sunday and all the days of our lives and forever.
Amen.
Only begotten Son, you were born of the Father before all ages, and by your creative will you separated light from darkness on this, the first day of the week. You fashioned all creation to honor Adam, the image of your majesty. We praise and thank and celebrate you, proclaiming, blessed are you, for you appeared in the flesh on earth like us, and you lived among us. Blessed are you, for you were buried and counted among the dead, and you shined your light in the dark sadness of the tomb. Blessed are you, for you rose to life, giving good hope to all. And you filled the angels with radiance, and they peered at your tomb like flashes of lightning. Now, O Christ, we ask you with the fragrance of this incense to make us worthy to rejoice in the glory of your radiant resurrection. Breathe life into our departed, and make them worthy to stand at your right hand in your eternal light, that you have prepared for those who love you. With them we praise and thank you for your graces and glorify you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, forever.
Thank you.
joy from the mountains. Sunday is a feast so great. Offer praise to the Lord God, and with angels
to the world. Let us
listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls. The Lord Jesus says, "Whoever has my commandments and observes them is the one who loves me. And whoever loves me shall be loved by my Father, and I will love him and reveal myself to him." Judas, not the Iscariot, said to him, "Master, then what has happened that you shall reveal yourself to us and not to the world?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Whoever loves me shall keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our dwelling with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. Yet the word you hear is not mine, but that of the Father who sent me. I have told you this while I am with you. The Advocate, the Holy Spirit that the Father will send in my name, he will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have told you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, nor afraid." This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Back to Greek yet. The Romans had put their impress over it,
But it's a new city, it's rebuilt, and it's a port city, and there's money, and it's cosmopolitan, and there is wealth. And so the people in Corinth are not only happy to be Corinthians, they think that they're also quite something as Christians, called by the fact that they live in Corinth. And what St. Paul is doing is he's contrasting what is the wisdom of God and the wisdom of man. How human beings think compared to the way that God thinks. So this wisdom in this contrast is going to give the second notion in this letter to the Corinthians is about maturity, growing up. St. Paul will speak about those who lack maturity. Usually that's the way it's translated that we have. But the word is literally perfection. Those who have been perfected. Perfected doesn't mean that they're wonderful and extraordinary. Perfected means they have arrived at being fully formed. The word in English, perfection, from the Latin facere, means to make, to accomplish, to do something. And per facere literally means to make something thoroughly. So perfection, perfectio, the word literally means the action of thoroughly making something done. So perfection is the idea of being accomplished. In the Greek, it's related to teleos, the idea of accomplishing and arriving at our goal, the purpose of why we exist. So St. Paul is going to use wisdom on one hand and then talk about perfection, arriving at where we're supposed to be. So what he's contrasting is the Corinthians are holding themselves out as being very wise, very spiritual, very supernatural people. But in fact, St. Paul is going to point out to them is that you are completely wrong about this. That you are, in fact, are quite immature. You are infants. And as I mentioned to you before, the word infant in our English word is another Latin word. Infans literally means in Latin, doesn't speak, non-speaking. It doesn't communicate. It screams, but it doesn't talk. That's the idea of infant. Which is why we used to have a Maronite tradition that about the age of two or whenever mother finally decides she's going to cut her little boy's hair for the first time, that historically among the Maronites has always been the signification of moving from baby, infant, to child. And in fact, we have a whole ceremony of blessing. So if you have another child coming up at some point and it's time for his haircut, his first haircut, mom's going to cry. I mention this because I know some mothers who have kept it growing until the age of three or four. And it's down past their shoulders. But there is a ceremony among the Maronites for the blessing of that moment when the child will move from being non-speaking infant to now a child who is beginning to learn, to absorb, and communicate. That's an aside. But it's pertinent to the Corinthians because they think not only are they beyond the age of being infants in spiritual life, they think that they're quite advanced in the paths of the gospel. And St. Paul is pointing out then that you're not. And that there is always a process of moving forward. So that Sophia, wisdom, when it resonates against the Old Testament background, the Torah, the book of law of Moses, the first five books, what we call the Torah, that is considered by the Jews, was considered the embodiment of divine wisdom, God communicating and directing us to mature. The books of wisdom, Ecclesiasticus, the book of wisdom itself, the books of Solomon, they gave us also the art of prudence or art of insightful living in the Old Testament. In fact, the book of Sirach, Ben Sirach, was so important and so used in the preparation of the catechumens in the first centuries of the church, it's also known as the book of Ecclesiasticus, which of course again is a Latin word, meaning that this is the church's book, because this was the book they taught the infant Christians walking on the path of insightful living to prepare them for the day of their baptism. And lastly, the resonation in the Old Testament is there is a sharp contrast between the human wisdom and the divine wisdom, which is precisely what St. Paul is bringing forward in this letter to the Corinthians. So it's important because these two Sundays are going to go back to back. Next Sunday, we're just going to continue the next six verses of this, in which he's going to talk about how the Spirit of God itself within us moves us along, matures us, and develops us. But he also mentions that when I first arrived among you, so he's writing this letter, he has already been to Corinth, he has already preached there, he already knows some of the people. But he says, that you remember that when I came among you, I came in great simplicity, and in fear and in trembling. Now when we hear that, it makes it sound like he was terrified of these people in Corinth. That's not what he's saying. What he was reminding them is that I did not come to you with all of the Greek artifice of rhetoric and logic and syllogisms and arguments and all the things that you would have expected. But I came among you simply and showed forth in trembling and in fear. Again, it's an echo of the Old Testament. This is the reverential awe before the divine presence. Moses being told on Mount Sinai, take off your sandals, this is holy ground. This awe and the reverence of the presence of God among us. So St. Paul is aware that when he comes among the Corinthians, he's bringing the gospel. He is bringing the proclamation of life from death. That's what he's bringing. Not artifice, not talent in the human sense, but the power of grace which is lived and experienced and brought forward. And so what he's immediately reminding by that one phrase to the Corinthians is, you are not living grace. You are not experiencing the transformation that is meant to be taking place within your lives. And when you do, that perfection from inside out will develop and will draw forward from imperfection to perfection, which are the literal terms, or as we've had it translated in the lectionary today, from immaturity to maturity. So it's the difference between the disciples who are adults, who are matured spiritually, and those who remain children. St. Peter will use the same terms. He will say that you're not capable of receiving the meat of wisdom. So we give you only the milk of infants. Which sounds like he's going easy on them, but that's actually quite a hard statement. Saying you're not able to learn more. And so when we look at this epistle, and again I encourage you to read chapter 1 and chapter 2, because he begins this letter by telling the Corinthians, just look around yourself, stop looking at your city. And then amongst you there's nobody who's that important, there's nobody who's that powerful. And so stop being under the illusion of being in Corinth and think about yourselves as what you are as human beings individually. That's chapter 1. And then he begins with chapter 2 that we begin today. So that what we can finish with is when he speaks about mystery. He's saying that you have to have a disposition to understand the mind of God. Baptism, that's the beginning. That starts us on the path. That's like in the equivalent of the natural order of our birth. Most of us, obviously we didn't do anything about our birth. We didn't pick our parents, we didn't pick where we came in, we didn't pick when we arrived through screening. We just arrived. Well, baptism may have, as an adult, of course, a conversion aspect that we embrace the gospel. But for many of us, we're born into Catholic families and we're baptized. Baptism is given to us. And so what St. Paul is pointing out, that baptism is the beginning of this work. The Spirit of God is meant then to continue and to develop within us this wisdom, the insightfulness, and not just simply insightfulness to live according to the gospel, but insightfulness to enter into and to have a knowledge of the mind of God. What God has done for the human race as a whole, we've talked about Israel and the Gentiles these last weeks, but also how he works within the individual soul of the revelation of life in death. that when the cross weighs upon us individually, that the mind of God and God's desire is that resurrection be developed within us and be brought forward in resurrection and in life. So that this divine mystery, what has been hidden in God, he says, from before the foundation of the world, of the redemptive death and resurrection within the Messiah, but which is meant to be shared by each of us individually. He says that once was concealed to all the pagan nations, they had no idea what God did. They worshiped trees. They worshiped rocks. They worshiped people. They worshiped animals. They had no idea what the divine mind was. But even for the Jews, it was only foreshadowed images of what God intended to do through the prophets and through Moses. So that's why when he finishes, he's saying, you have a great gift. It's not the city of Corinth. It's not the money you may have. But what is important, and that's why he quotes that from Isaiah, and probably the book of Sirach, he combines the two quotations together, that eye has not seen and ear has not heard. This profound depth and sublime beauty of what God desires to accomplish in each one of your lives individually at Corinth, in order to bring you from your infancy into maturity. But notice that he adds on to it from Sirach for those who love him. It's a response of love for love. We cannot, it's written in the bulletin this week, because we couldn't make the sermon long for an hour, of course. One, because I'll go hoarse and you'll all fall asleep and bump your heads on the pews. But there's an aspect in which knowledge, what he's talking about in wisdom, is the knowledge of who God is. And that knowledge, as it becomes deeper, provokes a desire to know more, to love more. So we spend our days dating before marriage. You've got to find out who this person is. Knowledge, what we do not know, we cannot love. And when we have knowledge, it will provoke that love, and love will provoke a desire for greater knowledge. We talk, we communicate. And with our friends and with those whom we love, our desire is to know more about them and to listen, to communicate. And when that love isn't there, when that knowledge isn't there, well, they may be acquaintances. They may be people that we know. We may know there is a God, St. Paul would say. But we do not love. And because we do not love, it's often because we do not know. And because we do not know and do not love, we do not enter deeper, and we remain in infancy. That's what he's telling the Corinthians. And therefore, quoting from the Old Testament, from Isaiah and from Ben Sirach, he's saying that God will reveal what you cannot possibly imagine, what eye has not seen, what ear has not heard. He will reveal to those who love, those who desire to know this. And this is revealed to us, St. Paul says, by the Spirit. And that leads us then, and prepares us for next week in the discussion of what the Spirit does in our lives. But may God grant us both the desire to know more. It's not hard. It just takes a bit of effort, consciousness, awareness, sophia, insight. So that knowledge may lead to a greater love, and that love to a greater desire to know even more. That is the greatest gift we can actually ask for, because in doing that, the foundation goes deeper in the life of the gospel that we share and embrace as being disciples of our Lord and baptized Catholics. So that we have this knowledge and this love, so that we may reach the full perfection and maturity of disciples in Christ. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen.
Alleluia. 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 this offering.
Amen.
the anaphora of the 12 apostles on page 754. 754. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Virgin Mary, and by his divine plan he saved.
and redeemed us. Kyrie eleison. Laudiamo patrem tuum pascam illam et paem. En salve Maria, conditio Peter, our retired patriarch, Gregory John, our bishop, and all the bishops of the true faith. With blameless lives and with purity and holiness, may they guide your church and present to you a faithful people who honor your name. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, your people here before you, especially those who have presented these offerings. Forgive them so that they may always live blameless lives in your presence, and recognize the blessings that you bestow upon them, for you are good and rich in graces. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, civil leaders throughout the world, that they may stand for justice and establish peace. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, your holy church that you have established on the solid rock of the true faith, and send her vocations to the holy priesthood and religious life. In a world of distractions which pull us away from properly loving you and our neighbor, may those whom you have called to serve your holy church respond to you and have courage to follow your will. We pray to you, Lord. Especially Mary, the Blessed Holy Mother of God, and the prophets, apostles, martyrs, and confessors, John the Baptist, Stephen the Archdeacon, Saint Joseph, Saint Jude, and Saint Alta. Assist us through their prayers and make us worthy to rejoice with them in your kingdom. We pray to you, O Lord. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the faithful departed who have left us and have gone to their rest awaiting you, awaiting that life-giving voice calling them to life. Accept the offerings that we present to you on their behalf, and have mercy on them in your kingdom. Through our Lord Jesus, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins.
Oh.
Compassionate Lord, may we, your lowly servants, be made worthy to pray with purity and holiness, and to call upon you, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Yes, O Lord, lover of all people, deliver us from the evil one and from his deceitful ways. And do not forsake us, lest temptation overcome us. For yours is the kingdom with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirits.
O Lord, bless your faithful people who bow before you. Deliver us from all harm and make us worthy to share in these divine mysteries of purity and holiness, that through them we may be forgiven and made holy. And we raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the most holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
Amen. And with your spirit.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity. One holy
Father, one holy Son, one holy Spirit. Blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord God,
so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins, and for one night, O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
Thank you. Oh.
Thank you, Lord God and Father, and we ask that this divine communion be for the forgiveness of sins and the glory of your holy name, and that of your only Son and of your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lord Jesus, our God and Savior, you became flesh for our sake, and by sacrificing yourself, you saved us. Deliver us from damnation, and make us temples of your holy name. For we are your people and your inheritance. We glorify and honor you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Now we have one announcement to make. You may know, or may not know, that the Apostolic See of Rome, the Vatican, has a number of orders of chivalry, same way that the Queen of England will make knights and dove. So also the Holy See throughout the centuries has also elevated, ennobled, and recognized service in this case, of the Catholic Church. So in these 30 years of priesthood at this point, I have had few announcements with which I make with greater joy. And I had to wait for her return from Syracuse. That at the request of Bishop Gregory, we've been working on this since September, so don't worry. That at the request of Bishop Gregory, the Secretary of State of the Apostolic See has accepted the request to enroll and to elevate Fifa D to the order of St. Gregory the Great. And I thank you.
Spirit of one God, to whom be glory forever.